T-Hood's. T-Hood's going to open us up in a word of prayer, and we'll get going.
Hope everybody's good this morning. Thanks for coming. Father, we come before you this morning humbled. We thank you for you, and we thank you for your word. We thank you for telling us the end from the beginning. We know our time is short, Father, so help us please be better stewards of the time left. Let us know, Father, what you would have of us before we reach the bema seat of our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us be better witnesses and better stewards of our time. Help us be more like your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us love like Jesus Christ. We solicit your Holy Spirit's presence this morning, Father, to illuminate your word and prepare our hearts for this message this morning. We ask these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. All right, so real quick review from last week. We spent the entire session discussing Jesus' command in Matthew 24 to watch. We learned what it means to watch, and I think that all we do is this. This is watching, right? I just look up. Yeah. So we're not just looking up. We learned that watching is paying attention to our surroundings, paying attention to what's going on in the world, really study God's Word, open up what we would consider eschatology books, speaking about His second coming. We went over what Paul had to say about staying awake and being sober. Paul clearly states that staying awake, a good awake Christian is going to understand what's going on. The world may see the world spiraling out of control right now, but the awake Christian can see some of the good through the bad, can see what's really going on God's whole scene, and we'll actually talk about that a little today. We discussed the Greek word parousia, which when you read your Bible, it talks about the coming of Jesus Christ. The Greek word is parousia, and when you study the Greek context, you'll learn that there's actually multiple stages to the second coming of Christ. And we look at the differences in that, the rapture versus second coming. And we're not going to cover that in great detail yet because we will study that later. But just as a reminder, the rapture, there's no signs for the rapture. Jesus can come and take his church at any second. Could happen today. Could happen right now, hopefully. But as far as the second coming, where Jesus sets up his literal millennial kingdom on earth, there are signposts for that to watch and to study and to learn. And we are seeing some of those signs come to pass. So, with us as believers, if we see the second coming, where he's going to set up his literal kingdom coming to pass, how much more close is that rapture where we get to meet our bridegroom in the air? And we finished with a note on zealots. Zealots are just people who are extremely excited, right? For 2,000 years, Christians have been crazily saying that Jesus is coming back, right? All those crazy Christians, they've always been saying Jesus is coming back. Well, actually, that's biblical. Every Christian generation, Jesus could have came back. So that's actually a good thing. And according to 2 Peter 2, those scoffers, especially the scoffers in the end times that question the second coming of Christ, is actually a fulfillment of prophecy. So when we hear people today say, oh, Jesus is, we've heard Jesus is coming back for 2,000 years, you know, that's actually fulfillment of biblical prophecy. So we're going to get into... We're finishing today the seven reasons to study eschatology. So once again, all we're doing is we're building a foundation stone as to why it's important for us to study the book of Revelation. So you guys will notice in your notebook, if anybody doesn't have a notebook, we can get you a notebook after class, and we'll get you all caught up. But we're going over 7 points to study eschatology. What's cool, we've just studied the first one, which is what the Bible says about why we should watch. Now we're going to go through those last seven today. There's last six. And what we just learned last week, biblical watching for the return of Christ, that fulfills or produces all of our next points that are coming up. And you guys will see what I mean by that. So, reason number two to study eschatology is urgency. So the question we need to ask ourselves, what would you do if you knew Jesus was coming next week? What would your guys' lives look like if Jesus was actually coming a week from today. I don't know about you guys, but I would be, you know, running to the hills, running to my family, running to everybody. I could probably get a megaphone. I'd probably be one of those street preachers on the corner saying, the end is near, you know. But that just kind of illustrates, if we really believe that Jesus is coming back, how much more urgent should we be with our friends and our family? And I've always firmly believed that each one of us has what I like to call a circle of influence. And by that I mean that you have a group of people in your lives that only you can get through to, only you can discuss. And I believe personally, one of the things that I'm doing in my intercession prayers is I always pray that I would be a good steward of my circle of influence. Whether that's one person, whether that's 100, whether you're Tim Tebow and you've got millions, you're accountable to your circle of influence. So that's kind of a note on urgency. So urgency, if we really see all this stuff coming to pass, how much more should we be talking to our friends and our family about some of the things that are coming to pass? Check out this verse from Paul. Romans 13, he says, and do this, and this he's talking about live pure, live holy lives in love. He's saying, and do this knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. So what Paul's telling us here is he's saying, knowing the time. Paul believed that Jesus could come back in his lifetime. He's saying it's go time. We know that the day is at hand. That's actually an idiom for the return of Christ, because right now the world is kind of dark, but when Jesus comes back, the day is at hand. So he's saying, with all that in mind, we need to live pure and holy lives with the thought of Jesus coming back. So that brings us to our third point. We should live pure. So when you study eschatology, there's a good side effect to studying eschatology. It makes you live a more pure life. Once again, one of the things I'm always thinking about is, if Jesus came and took me right now, would he be happy with what I was doing? You know, you have that accountability. Would you be happy? Would Jesus be happy with what you're doing right now? Also, in terms of your circle of influence, in terms of your ministry, would Jesus be pleased with you right now if he took you today? Would he say to you, well done, good and faithful servant? So if we're constantly, if we're studying eschatology, we're looking for his return, that is going to enable us or push us to live more pure, more lives. The way I look at it is, we don't do works just for the sake of earning eternal rewards, but Scripture clearly states that we do works and we will be rewarded for them, so that's kind of a good little motivating factor. Bettering your report card before Jesus comes, right? Who doesn't do that? Who doesn't want to do that? So, the second half of that verse we just looked at there, where Paul says, live pure, live holy, because salvation is nearer than when we first believe. Every day that passes by, we're that much closer to Jesus. He says, therefore, here. And anytime you see the word therefore, it's easy. What's it there for, right? So if it's a therefore, he's saying, go back and check what it's there for. So because time is so short, Paul says, let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in lewdness and lust, not in strife and envy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. So because we see salvation drawing near, therefore we should live more pure and healthy lives. Does that make sense? As we see that, as we see him coming, we should really be wanting to live more pure. So the question is, what will you be doing? This is one of my favorite verses. Beloved, now we are children of God, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be. But we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone who has this hope, and this hope is meeting Jesus in the air, being transformed into his likeness. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. So think about what that's saying. Jesus is saying, as you look to me, as you long to meet me, as you long to be transformed by me, In that process, you're being purified.
It's also a slight reference to when it says, we shall see him as he is. One of our favorite teachers, Chuck Missler, teaches that. That's possibly a hyperdimensional statement. Right now, like we've mentioned it before, you can only see, height, length, width, and time as far as what we can perceive in our dimensions now. But we know Jesus walked through walls, and we know Jesus could just appear in the middle of a room out of nowhere. So that's an allusion to the rapture, that as soon as we're changed in the blink of an eye, we're all of a sudden now incorruptible. You'll have your spiritual, your immortal body, and then you can now see Jesus in his hyperdimensional state, what a human looks like glorified and not fallen. That's a reference to the rapture right there.
Titus 2, verse 11 through 13, Paul says, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ." So I think this verse is really cool because Paul lists these things, how to live a holy life, denying ungodliness, worldly lust, live soberly, righteously, godly. And one of those keys to living that life is looking for the blessed hope, looking for it. That's a clear reference to Jesus coming and taking us. The blessed hope, Jesus is our hope. Even as if we see the world in a state where it's kind of scary right now, our blessed hope is Jesus coming. We always have that hope. So, reason number four to study eschatology is this will improve our biblical witness. I think it's really cool that in this class we have a living, breathing testimony to what prophetic or eschatological witness can bring. T. Hood here, he had, like we've already discussed, he had lots of questions for me about stuff that's going on in the world and lots of stuff about wars and blah, blah, blah. And because I had been studying eschatology, I was able to answer some of those questions. So I just think it's really cool that in this class we have a living, breathing example of what witness, a prophetical witness can bring. So I don't know if you had anything to say about.
Sure, yeah. I went, the first thing that he brought to my attention was the regathering of Israel. We talked before about how the prophecy in Ezekiel that alludes to May 14, 1948 as the day that Israel would be regathered. That's an incredible prophecy, but at the same time, we know that since they are regathered, it's very possible that the end time scenario can be triggered because they are regathered into the land. That's one of the prerequisites for the second coming, not for the rapture, but for the second coming. So that's a big thing. And then one of the first passages I think the Lord led me to, when I first got saved is in 2 Thessalonians. And what Paul's doing here is he's writing to the Thessalonians and he's making some corrections. He's trying to clear up, they had some misconceptions about the day of the Lord. They thought that they were in the day of the Lord. So they thought that they were already, seeing the end time scenario play out. But he's writing to them to let them know, hey guys, when I was with you, I taught you this stuff. And I'm just going to read this passage. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And you know what is restraining him. And when he's talking about him, he's talking about the Antichrist. Restraining him so now that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he's taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed. Talking about the Antichrist again. Whom the Lord Jesus will kill with the breath of his mouth and bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders and with the wicked deception for those that are perishing because they refuse to love the truth, so be saved. Therefore, God sends them. And when it says God sends them, it's saying that God will allow a strong delusion so that they may believe what is false in order that they may be condemned, who will not believe the truth but have pleasure in unrighteousness. The thing that really popped out to me was this strong delusion. What could possibly be the strong delusion that's coming upon the whole world? So when the Antichrist is revealed, what is this strong delusion that's going to, captivate the world and take the world over? What could that possibly be? And I look back to a time before I had the Lord Jesus Christ in my life, and I saw You know, I had this evolution paradigm, my secular education, high school education, college education, that led me into the paradigm of evolution, that we started as nothing, and, you know, through evolution, we got to this point, and the continuation of evolution, you know, we're going to eventually be like gods. And for anybody that's studied some of this stuff seriously and knows, you know, what's going on in the world of transhumanism with the integration of robotics and software into the integration of our human brain and things like that, you know, they're talking about some of like the lead technocrats at Google are saying it's possible within the next 30 years to upload our consciousness into a computer and crazy things like that, developing super soldiers and things like that. You look at that and you're like, okay, by our own intellect and through evolutionary processes, we're going to be gods. And that goes right back to Genesis, the lie in the garden that you won't die, you know, eat from the tree of knowledge and you'll be like God. You know, and that's always been man's goal, is to be like God. So Satan's countermove to God is, oh, I'm gonna give these humans this deception that they can be gods without Jesus' provision for salvation. And so you have this evolutionary paradigm that's really driving that. And when that verse was illuminated to me by the Holy Spirit, it clicked. It's like, okay, now I really do see some of these things in the world coming to pass. You have things on TV that are teaching kids that there's a way to be saved without Jesus' provision of salvation. It's going to be our own intellect and pulling ourselves up by our own bootstraps. So that really pulled me out of the gutter and made me realize, oh my gosh, you know, we can be like gods in 30 years. You know, I'm not setting a date or anything like that, but that's incredible. You think Jesus is going to allow that to happen? Absolutely not. You know, so we really need to be watching and paying attention to stuff like that.
So kind of what piggybacking off T. Hood right there, as we learn and study eschatology, we can explain technologically prophetic statements. Real quick, just in Matthew 24, just a few different verses here. Jesus describing some of the things that will be in the end times. Earthquakes in various places. People will be able to see what's known as the abomination of desolation. And he says if those days hadn't been shortened, no flesh would be left alive. What's kind of crazy is that those verses can be seen as technological verses as well. 1,000 years ago, would we have ever even been able to know that there were earthquakes in diverse places? Not at all, you know. When you see, and he's in context there, he's warning all the people of the world, when you see the abomination of desolation, the abomination of desolation is described in Daniel. We'll talk a lot about that, but that happens when the Antichrist presents himself as God in the rebuilt temple that's coming. How can the whole world see that before the invention of the TV, right? No flesh would be saved. 1,000 years ago, when people were running around with, what was 1,000 years? Bows and arrows? Bows and arrows, you didn't really have a threat of the entire world being destroyed, right? So now we have thousands of nuclear warheads pointed at us. And we have thousands of nuclear warheads pointed at other countries. For the first time in human history, it is possible that we could send thousands of nukes over at Russia and blah, 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 and we could destroy the entire Earth. And obviously God's not going to let that happen. But just kind of giving you guys a heads up there, we're going to see technological statements like that. And obviously one of the big things we're going to cover as we study Revelation is the mark of the beast. And there's so much bad stuff out there about Mark of the Beast. If I can give you guys any calm right now, don't ever worry that you're going to take the Mark of the Beast on accident. Whatever they come out with now, if it's a card that we all have to carry or whatever, you will never accidentally take the Mark of the Beast. It's clear from Scripture that when you take this mark, you're pledging allegiance to the Antichrist. So, but anyway, how crazy is it right now that we're seeing technology where they're literally saying they want to insert chips in hands and put things on forehead. I mean, just how John saw this stuff 2,000 years ago and was able to convey it to us today, that's mind-blowing. And to be able to explain that to somebody is huge witness in validating what the Bible has to say, and we'll cover stuff like that. So, as long as witness goes, T. Hood mentioned this, we can explain the significance of prophetically relevant issues. Once again, as we've already stated, you guys are going to hear me come back to this over and over again, Israel regathered in its land. After 1,900 years, the people group of Israel was reestablished in their land. And what's even crazier is a lot of people don't realize The Hebrew was a dead language. Hebrew was over. These Jews came back into their land in Israel, and they brought back to life the ancient language of Hebrew, which I don't have this in your notes, but you guys may want to write this verse down. Jeremiah 31, verse 23, literally discusses that when Israel's regathered in the land, that they will go back to using Hebrew. Like that this is absolutely crazy. There, do you guys see any Hittites today?
Yeah.
Any Canaanites rolling around?
Where are the Egyptians? Where are the Babylonians? Where are all these ancient, you know, technologies? Or I'm sorry, not technologies, but where are these ancient people groups and cultures? And could you imagine if all of a sudden Egypt started speaking and writing in hieroglyphic language again? Hebrew was gone. It didn't exist. And now you have scholars. Not only you have, you know, major universities, Hebrew universities in Israel, teaching Hebrew, like the same language that was used, you know, thousands of years ago. It's remarkable. It's unheard of. It's absolutely incredible.
God uses the people of Israel. If there's ever a greater, obviously the number one miracle is salvation. Every single person that's born again from the Spirit of God is the greatest miracle there is. But other than that, the people group of Israel still existing throughout the entire, what we know is 6,000 years of human history, is absolutely breathtaking, especially when you look at what they've been through, and we'll discuss some of that. There are also some major coalitions described in the Bible. For instance, we'll cover this war, this famous war in Ezekiel 38 and 39. You guys may hear a lot of people talk about the Gog and Magog war. But what's crazy about Ezekiel 38 and 39 is it describes a coalition that modern scholars say is Russia, and it also includes Iran. What's crazy about that is we've just seen this recently develop within the last 5 to 10 years. Russia and Iran have never had any kind of ties before in the past, and now we have Russia building nuclear plants for Iran. Those are prophetically significant issues that we could be talking to people about, creating dialogue with people about. So finally, in terms of witness, we can provide hope. I got to work with my dad a couple weeks ago, and I listened to my normal podcasts. You know, some of them are really good, but some of them I listen to a lot of geopolitical stuff. And when you study geopolitical stuff, on the world scene right now, it's not looking pretty, right? It's not looking good. So my dad says, how do you listen to this stuff? Aren't you scared? And I said, it was a great opportunity for me because I got to explain to my dad. I said, no, I'm not scared. I've read the end of the book, you know? And that was a really good intro to explain to him that only the Christian worldview right now has hope. That the world is spiraling out of control. And unless you have Jesus, I really don't understand how you can have hope. So that's what we can provide with witness. Number five for why we study eschatology. We'll get a greater understanding of God's plan and how he works. So really learning who God is. You'll learn who he is when you study how he's gonna unveil all this stuff that's coming on the world. So here I wanna hash this out a little bit. I wanna see how we can apply this. So does anybody have an idea why there is a 7-year tribulation? So why is there a 7-year tribulation coming? Does anybody have a guess?
Still gives a chance.
Amen. Absolutely. That what she said was to give people a chance. That's going to be my reason number two that you'll see. It's kind of like a final draw the line in the sand, you know? God is the ultimate cosmic gentleman. He doesn't force himself on you. Man has free will, but eventually he has to step in, right? And what we'll see is the 7-year tribulation is the culmination of that. I want to show you guys something here. I want to show you a verse. When I read this verse, this was almost like fireworks going off in my brain. I couldn't believe how cool this verse really is. This is from the book of Hosea 5:15. And here's what I want you to get. This is God speaking, okay? This is, thus saith the Lord. He says, I will return again to my place. So this is God saying, I will return. So where's God's place, first of all? Does anybody know? It's not a trick question. God, heaven, right? So God's place is heaven. So when did God leave heaven?
Jesus,
right? Absolutely. So I will return again to my place until they acknowledge their offense, Then they will seek my face. In their affliction, they will earnestly seek me. So what Jesus is saying here is he's saying, I will return to my place until my people acknowledge what they did, acknowledge that they missed me as Messiah, acknowledge that they missed Jesus as the Savior of the world. And then what's going to happen is they're going to be tried. They're going to enter this affliction, and in that affliction, they will seek me. So let me explain this. One of the purposes for the tribulation is what's known as a conversion of a Jewish remnant. You guys got to understand, God made a promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He promised multiple things, and one of the things that he promised is that the Jewish race would always be, and that they will have a kingdom with Jesus ruling. So we are going to see, for sure, Jesus fulfilling all of these promises. And what's beautiful about that is if we see him fulfill promises to the Jews, we know that every promise that he makes to us is just as sure, right? So he's going to bring the conversion of a Jewish remnant. Jesus described this right here, Matthew 23, verse 37 through 39. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who sent her. This is Jesus speaking, by the way. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more till you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. So many times we skim when we're reading, right? Notice that key word there. You will see me no more till you say, or until you say, speaking to the Jewish people. We'll study this, but you guys are going to learn there is a prerequisite for the second coming of Christ. That prerequisite is the Jewish people repenting and acknowledging that Jesus is their Messiah, and we'll see that. So this tribulation, this seven-year period, God is going to back Israel into a corner with the Antichrist and with this world system that's going to persecute and kill them. But ultimately what it's going to bring is it's going to bring a conversion of a remnant, and we'll discuss that. So how can we apply that? Well, like we said, God loves the Jewish people and he isn't finished with them. So if we know that he's faithful to them, why would he be anything but faithful to us? So once again, by studying eschatology, we learn just how perfect to every jot and tittle is God is with every promise he makes. And that includes you and me. So reason number two, let's read Revelation 3:10 here. Because, and this is a promise to the Church of Philadelphia, and we'll discuss a lot of the specifics of this, but I just want to give you a general idea. He says, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. And we'll break all this stuff down, but clearly this is talking about a specific testing period that comes on the entire world. And I believe that we can truly say that this hasn't happened yet. But notice that Jesus says, I will keep you from the hour of trial.
He's speaking to the church. This is the letter to the Church of Philadelphia, so he's talking to believers.
And we'll discuss all the specifics of this, but he is talking to the Church of Philadelphia, a specific church at that time, but we'll also realize that all throughout the book of Revelation, Jesus says, he who has an ear, let him hear. You and I have ears, right? He's talking to us, too. So, this is a promise in the Church of Philadelphia that they will be kept from the hour of trial. Now, the Church of Philadelphia has been gone for 2,000 years, right? So, that has to be referring to a later period, and that'll be us, and we'll talk about that. But notice what I want you to see, what's the point of this? It's to test those who dwell on the earth, okay? So like we've already discussed, the reason for this tribulation is to test those. So testing an unbelieving world to prove that they deserve judgment. You guys got to understand, God, he's a perfectly just God. He knows everything that's going to happen, right? But ultimately, it's like a court of law. Like our existence is kind of like a court of law. He's going to let it play out. He's going to let man make that decision, and that way everybody will have that accountability piece. So he's going to let that play out. So the question that we need to ask ourselves in terms of testing the world to prove that they deserve judgment, do we as a believing church, do we as believers in Jesus Christ, do we need to be tested? I don't believe so. When it's talking about tests here, it's talking about a pass-fail test, right? If you put your trust in Jesus Christ, you get what's called imputed righteousness. You get the imputed righteousness of Christ. It's like a report card, right? If I'm getting B's, C's, and D's, which stinks, right? And I have to present that before God. That would stink, right? But no, when I present my report card to God, I get straight A's in terms of righteousness because of Jesus. Okay? We have no need to be tested. No need at all. And now, that's not, of course, there are tests that we walk in terms of faithfulness and stuff, but we're talking about salvation.
Yeah, this is completely judicial and soteriological, meaning salvation. You know, our righteousness comes from Christ. We have no judgment coming upon us as, you know, for our unfaithfulness, and we've already decided that we've taken Christ's imputed righteousness. And this hour of trial coming upon the whole world to test them is because they didn't take Christ's provision for salvation. We did. And that's, you know, another picture that we're not going to be here. So,
well, yeah, and that's described right here in Revelation 3:10. To test those who dwell on the earth. The Greek word is earth dwellers. It's people that think that this earth is all there is. They're honing and they're focusing on down here. See, Scripture clearly says that us who are in Christ, we're heavenly people. We're to be looking up. The earth isn't our final destination. That's why we're pilgrims. We're passing through, right? We don't cling to our house. We don't cling to our stuff. We don't cling to this life. And that's why we don't need to be tested. So greater understanding of God's plan and how he works. As we quickly stated earlier, we can even see the good and the bad. Here's what I want you guys to understand. Right now, you guys are seeing the news media finally is covering what we would call radical Islam, right? Finally, they're showing these things that I wouldn't recommend watching, these beheadings, these blah, blah, blah. You're hearing about ISIS. You're hearing about radical Islam. Satan wants people to live in fear, right? So we're getting that fear, that propaganda. But, and I was talking to my wife, Melissa, about this last night, what people don't see is what's going on behind the scenes. What is God really doing? Did you guys know that in certain places like Iran, there are massive conversions to Jesus happening as we speak? Satan, he's got to understand, well, he does understand, the first century church was birthed by the blood of the martyrs. So killing Christians really isn't the best thing, because in all actuality, it will grow the church. So just so you guys know, although we're seeing ISIS and these scary things, just know that behind the scene, God is allowing stuff like that. God's in control. This isn't surprising him, right? But if you guys understood the ministry that's happening in Iran, millions of people coming to Christ. I'm hearing things and reading reports that Jesus is coming to Muslims in dreams and visions and saving people. How many people right now are getting disillusioned with radical Islam? It's kind of like people are seeing how bad this stuff is, and how could I serve a God like that? Is that really what God would want? Is that what a God would want me to do? And they're turning from it, okay? So we always got to see that God's got a plan for this. It's not catching them by surprise, and we can understand that. So learning about God through eschatology will also lead to other areas of theology. So as you're studying eschatology, we're not just going to focus on the end of the world, right? It's going to lead us to other things, other major areas of study. For instance, as I was preparing Revelation chapter 1, I was going crazy and studying pneumatology, which that's a big fancy word for studying the Holy Spirit, which you guys are going to love all this stuff. Because as I was studying Revelation chapter 1, I get to learn more of how the Holy Spirit works, what he's doing, etc. So just because we're focusing on eschatology, know that we'll be talking about a lot of this stuff. One last thing here on God's program. Notice in Daniel 12:4, it says, "But you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall increase." So notice that this is Daniel. And by the way, Daniel and Revelation are kind of like they go together. But he says, "Seal this up until the time of the end." So Daniel didn't, when we study some of what Daniel said, he didn't understand what was going on. He would get these prophecies and he would just weep, and he was really scared. But he says, "Seal it up until the time of the end."
You have to understand, Daniel's mindset was he's about to come out of Babylonian captivity. So he sees, you know, Israel as you know, they're about to be, you know, come out of captivity. It's going to be a great and glorious time, you know. But then he gets these visions and he's seeing all these, you know, visions of the apocalypse, and he's stressed out and he doesn't understand. And God tells him, "Hey, Daniel, when the time comes, these prophecies will be understood. But they're not for you to understand. Just write them down." And now we're starting to see these things that we can finally start to understand. So that's exciting.
Yeah. So many commentators, that part right there where it says many shall run to and fro, they don't really know what that means. Some people think it has to do with technology, meaning we'll be able to drive distances, whatever. But I think it's meaning people are going to be earnestly seeking the scriptures. They're going to be going back and forth. They're going to be really, people like us in this group are going to be studying eschatology. And a prophecy is that knowledge shall increase. We shouldn't be surprised here, and even in this group of people, as we study this, that the Holy Spirit can illuminate some stuff that maybe hasn't even been grasped for 2,000 years. That's not out of the scope of reality. We, as we open these things up, I believe absolutely right here that in the time of the end, that knowledge shall increase. We will learn. We will have a greater understanding of exactly what Daniel in Revelation was talking about. I think that this class right here is a fulfillment of this prophecy. So, kind of a really cool thing. Reason number 6, why study eschatology? Greater understanding of the enemy's game plan and how to fight it. I don't know about T-Hood, but one of my favorite things each week was we would watch game film as a football player. I played corner and wide receiver. So, every week, I would watch the opposing team's game, and I would hone in on that guy that I was going to be covering. I would hone in on that receiver that I was going to be covering. I would learn his moves. I would learn what he does in certain situations. I learned everything about him. Because why? Because I wanted to beat him. I'm sure you did the same thing. Yeah. So when we study eschatology, we're going to understand what Satan's doing too, right? And if we do that, if we understand his moves, we can learn how to protect ourselves better and protect those around us. And obviously, this is one of those areas where if you focus too much on what Satan and what he's doing, you get out of balance, right? So there's always that good and bad balance.
It's just good to be aware of what he's doing, but don't focus on him. You know, amen. Focus on living holy.
Do I got 5 minutes real quick? 9:43, and then we'll finish?
Yes.
Okay. So the enemy's game, if I got grandma's, okay, she's in charge this week, I see. So we know and from the book of Revelation, what's coming is an apostate. That just means a drifted away from truth. Apostate ecumenical end time world religion. We see in the book of Revelation, there's going to be this great big forced world religion on the world. Okay, so what ecumenical, that's a big fancy word. It just means all faiths join one. Okay, so you can be a Hindu, you can be a Jew, you can be a Christian, you can be a Muslim, you can be an atheist, you can be whatever, but just as long as you do your thing, I do my thing, as long as we can worship God, but what am I trying to say there?
Well, it's a ploy to take the world away from Jesus Christ.
Right.
As long as
any
you're
God
worshiping
but Jesus
a God, you know, you can't have a specific God, and we're seeing that. That's what's crazy. Mm-hmm. If you know some of the things that I'm not trying to bash Catholicism here, but you know some of the things that the Pope's saying, some of the things that are coming out of the Vatican about, you know, they need to embrace Islam and we worship the same God that Jehovah in the Old Testament is the same as Allah, and you're starting to see these things, this formation of a one world religion that as long as we love God and worship God, it's okay. When a Christian hears that, it should. You know, it can make you sick to your stomach to know that Allah is capricious. You can't trust him. You never know if you're saved. But in Jesus Christ, he is the way, the truth, and the life. And that should be our witness to the ecumenical movement is no, Christ is the only way. And then we'll get persecution for that. But know that you're walking in truth and that he is the truth. So,
and that leads me to my application. So if we see this ecumenical movement coming, what do we do? We need to protect ourselves from apostasy through deception. Pray for that wisdom and discernment that we're told over and over again to pray. Stand for the inspiration and sufficiency of the Bible. You guys, the number one way that Satan can get a church to be done is by saying that the Bible isn't inspired, that the Bible isn't the Word of God. So we take a stand on that. We take a stand for the inspiration and the sufficiency of the Bible and state the truth about Jesus being the only way. John 14. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. There's only one way. It's not a politically fun statement. It's just truth. And it's just a stand that we have to take, and we have to know that we will be persecuted for that. And I honestly foresee that as being hate speech. I foresee that being hate speech soon. So whatever that's going to look like, we'll see. But the big one here, as I've already said, is pray for discernment as we see this. Study and apply the seven pieces of the armor of God. Like I said, if you want to really combat Satan, you have to understand those seven pieces of armor. I wish I had time to go into that because that's like my favorite study. But number two, Satan wants to wipe out the Jewish race. So one of his goals is to wipe out the Jews. We've seen this throughout human history. We've seen the Holocaust. We've seen all kinds of stuff like that. So when I really grasped this, it blew my mind. One of the things I could never wrap my mind around is, why doesn't Satan just give up? Why doesn't he just be like, okay, I get it, I lost, right? Why does he continue to persecute the Jews? Why does he continue to want to wipe the Jews out? And I've come to the realization that one of the reasons Satan doesn't give up is he knows that if he can wipe out the entire Jewish race, then they can never call on Jesus to come back. And he can kind of catch God at his word. If he can break God at his word, then he can kind of catch God in a catch-22. That blew my mind when I grasped why he wants to wipe out the Jewish races so they can't call on Jesus to be saved. So the application of that is to be on the right side of the Semite discussion. I personally don't believe that any Christian should ever be an anti-Semite. And we also, the big one is pray for Israel and pray for the Jews. And we'll finish that last one next week. It's already 9:47. Does anybody have a real quick question? Drinking from a fire hose today, right? We'll get through this introduction stuff, and then once we get into actual Book of Revelation, things will start to settle in. But we'll pray and we'll get out of here. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for all these reasons that we discussed for studying eschatology. We thank you that you saved these revelations and that you promised us that as we seek knowledge that you would give it to us. God, we pray for that special blessing that you promised those who study the Book of Revelation. We pray that for this class. We pray that you continue to open our hearts and our minds to really grasping and understanding what's going on in the world, how we can be awake, how we can be a better witness, and how we can give this world hope as things continue to spiral out of control. Bless this day, God. We thank you. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.